broadcasting on a Labor Day 2012, but it could be any day. It's all the same. Existence is always the same. The message is always the same, no matter where you are in time and space and situation. A hypothetical cannot be transformed into an actual. That's why you cannot build heaven on earth. It's impossible, because you'd have to transform a hypothetical imaginary into an actual. It cannot be done. There is no power of transformation in reality, because everything that is created in reality is what it is from the very beginning and remains that way forever. So there's no transformational power in reality whatsoever. So there is no way to transform, transmute anything, any hypothetical, into the real, the actual. What happens is there's energetic transformations, but that is not the same as being transformed into the actual. Energy is like totally plastic, and you can transform it into constant transformations can take place because it's imaginary. This existence is the imaginary scenario, a hypothetical scenario we're imagining. And so, of course, anything in existence can be transformed into something else. We do that all the time with manufacturing stuff, goods of all types. You take, raw material, transform that, and then transform that into products, and just on and on and on. It's all transformational. Existence is continually transformational. But it can never be transformed into the actual. So the idea of building heaven on earth is totally delusional. That's the ego's plan of salvation. It's the way we keep believing that we can transform a hypothetical into the real. And actually, again, the purpose of existence is to develop a power over reality, a power that can threaten reality with destruction, so that we can force the prime creator to change reality and make us prime creator. That is what the purpose of existence is and will always be. Effects cannot separate from a cause. The purpose that effects serve can never be changed from the cause that gave rise to them. So the idea of somehow we can change the purpose of existence is crazy. It's insane. It's not possible. Existence will always be what it is. So your real goal is severalfold, but one part of it is to simply see existence as it is. See the loss that everything is undergoing constantly. Everything is slipping through your fingers. Your life is slipping away from you. Okay, everything you try to hold on to it slips away. Everyone's suffering loss. That is the nature of existence. That's what it is. It's trying to generate a power of loss, of destruction, of negation that can then threaten the prime creator and threaten reality. That's what it is. So simply see it as it is and then realize you can't change it. Nothing can change it. It cannot be transformed. You cannot have an idea with its effects and transform the effects to serve some other purpose. That's impossible. You can choose another idea that is closely aligned with the first idea and overlay the first idea, which is what we need to do. We need to choose the idea of not trying to be prime creator, which is very closely allied with the idea of trying to be prime creator. Except one is trying to change reality, one is simply accepting reality as it is. And so the effect of that second idea gives an experience of everything as it is, an effect that simply is not changing, is not being transformed in any way. So it's totally stable effect. It's not going to leave you. You're not going to lose it. You can't lose it. There's nowhere for it to go. It overlays everything. Unconditional love overlays everything equally. So you can't lose it. There's no place to put it. In order to lose something, you have to have some place to put it in, right? And then another place where it isn't. How can you put something that's everywhere somewhere where you can't find it? It's impossible. You cannot lose it. So these are the basics, and it's important to reiterate these basics, to keep emphasizing the basics. That is, the basics are all you need. Forget about all the details. This is not a detailed-oriented situation. It's a narrative that keeps any mistakes. Forgive everybody all their mistakes. Don't hold anybody to their mistakes, because mistakes simply have to be corrected. And if you're punishing people for mistakes and holding them to it, how can you correct it? What you have to do is give the correction. That's all. When everyone has misspoken and made mistakes, just forgive it all, forget it, let it all go. Keep on moving the narration forward. In your own life too, you've made mistakes. Forget about it. Don't hold yourself to any mistakes you ever made. Simply refocus and say, okay, what is existence? Let me see existence as it is. And you see it as it is, then you'll see the remedy too. You say, oh my gosh, I can't change existence. So I have to choose a new idea. As soon as you realize I cannot change existence, it's impossible. You can't take effects that arise from an idea, causative agent, and give those effects a different purpose. You have to choose a new causative agent that gives rise to effects that serve that purpose. It's the only way. If you could change the effects that arise from a causative agent, what you're really saying is you as spirit can change what you are because you're an effect of the prime creator. You see? It's the same delusion, same impossibility. So simply say, yes, existence is what it is. It is this horrible massacre, constant massacre taking place. It is a sacrificial belief system. Okay, it is a factory that just churns out death. That's all that it does. It manufactures energy forms and then transforms those energy forms. We call it death, change, all different terms we use, but it's changing what seems to be, what is, changing it, constantly changing it. Because we want to change what we are. We're spirit. We want to change what we are into being prime creator. So we believe that effects from an idea can be changed. They cannot. That's why existence just continues on the way it's always been and will always be. The way that existence comes to an end is to choose a different idea. But as long as you hold on to the idea of wanting to be prime creator, existence will continue to be what it is. That will arise. The effects will arise. And no way to change them. So if you see there's no way to change existence, you cannot bring heaven into existence. You cannot. You can overlay existence with heaven, as it were. The unconditional love can be an overlay, as it were. In other words, it's like existence would be like a faint shadow still there, but it's overlaid. And you see it doesn't affect unconditional love at all. It's like throwing rocks into a pond. There's no ripples. Unconditional love, no ripples. Stays perfectly calm. That you can do because you've chosen a different idea. But as far as transforming existence, it's impossible. And you get all these messiahs arise saying, I am here on earth, you know, to bring heaven down to earth, to transform earth into the kingdom of heaven, all this stuff. It is absolute nonsense. Cannot be done. Zero possibility of ever happening. All you're doing is just spinning your wheels in energy. Energy transforming into different patterns and forms and formats, etc. Which is nothing. Energy is again, the play of imagination. That's all that it is. It's not, reality is not based on any energy. It's not based on essence. So energy is the hypothetical, and it's always being transformed. So we think, oh, we should be able to transform the world. Well, you can change the world, you can transform it, but you cannot transform it into reality, into essence. It's not possible. Very simple message. It's not possible. So you simply, when you realize there's nothing you can do about existence, it is what it is. All the death, every destruction, that's what it is. Everything that's born dies. It's born to die. We should write a song, Born to Die, because that's the song of existence, born to die. Everything is born to die. That's it. That's what it is. And if you say, well, I don't really want that, great. Choose what you really want, which is to be reconciled with reality again. Be fully reconciled and translated, as it were. not existence. Don't translate existence. Translate spirit, your will, and your acceptance of reality as it is. Accept reality as it is. And the first step is to choose the idea of not trying to create it, to be prime creator, not trying to change reality. Let it be exactly as it is. And from that arises unconditional love, the experience of unconditional love throughout the whole universe that simultaneously arises and gives off the fragrance of remembrance of reality. That is the cure. That is the way out. That is what you really want. You really want to be free of existence. You don't want to keep struggling to try and bring heaven to earth. You don't want to try and keep trying to transform anything. There's no transformation in reality. All our efforts to transmute, to transform, is totally meaningless to reality. It doesn't teach us anything. We think, oh, we're learning how to transform. There's no transformation in reality. Those are waste, useless lessons. Totally useless. And so we don't really want to continue doing this. It's a complete waste of time. It's meaningless. And we have to engage in all sorts of distraction to keep doing it and keep sugarcoating existence. Pagan times are times when we sugarcoat existence. Whereas contemplative times is when we see existence as it really is and then decide that that's not what we really want. If we don't see it as it is, how can we know that's what we know that that's not what we really want? We keep thinking, oh, maybe this is what we really want. Maybe we're transforming it as we sugarcoat it. Pagan times is the body beautiful. Okay. And that's sugarcoating existence. And we think, well, maybe this is what we really want. You know, all these beautiful bodies everywhere. Dressed with you know, perfect teeth and perfect faces, blemish-free, beautiful clothing, beautiful attitudes, you know, confident attitudes like the hero has arrived, the goddess has arrived, and existence is full of the body beautiful, the goddess is here. That's sugarcoating existence that blinds you to seeing it as it really is. You don't want that. You don't really want that at all. And we're in those times. We're in severely pagan times as opposed to contemplative times. The scales have tipped so badly, it's virtually 100% pagan times now. And almost 0% contemplative times. The whole emphasis has gotten totally out of whack here. And these are the times we live in. That is existence. Existence will perpetually do that. You cannot establish contemplative times in existence as permanent. You cannot, because that's not the purpose of existence. You can temporarily use time that way here. You can use time, but you have to eventually choose a new idea. The purpose is not to turn existence into something that it's not. You can't do it. So contemplative times, you have to succeed at it. It's not an end in itself. You have to literally use the time very wisely, very intensely, and succeed. Otherwise, pagan times will return, and the sugarcoating of existence will take place, and you will have a very difficult time focusing and seeing that existence is what it is, and you don't want it. You don't really want it at all. And so we had 2,000 years on. We've had some time to do that. Here and there. It's been uneven. You know, it's not like there's been contemplative times that have just dominated. There are times when it was very strong and times when it was a little bit weaker. But right now, it's basically becoming extinct. Not to say that you cannot contemplate, cannot see existence as it is. That's all that's required. See it as it is, not as you want it to become. Okay, there is energy is always in a process of becoming, heating up, cooling down, heating up, cooling down. No change there at all. But it can never become what you really want. It can never become what you really want, not even remotely. Not even remotely. The entire play of energy is constantly transforming and changing. No stability whatsoever. No such thing as isness in energy. And You don't really want that at all. Not even remotely do you really want that. So, the pagan times is a demand of existence, demanding, don't see me as I am, see me as I want, you want me to be. Yeah. And sugarcoat it. Don't see it as it is, because if you do, you're going to set it down. So sugarcoat it. And that's what we have done. The modern world has been intensely, obsessively fixated on sugarcoating existence and showing all these beautiful people. We cannot get away from it. Our lives are saturated with beautiful people, beautiful bodies, saturated. And wherever we turn in the culture as a whole, that is the ideal. This ideal is being promoted more and more and more and more and more. And of course, it's going towards more and more youth, and trying to deflect our attention away from, wait a minute, old age, look at the old people, what's happening to them? When I go out, you know, I look at old people. You know, you see all these beautiful, you know, want starlets everywhere, that, you know, the whole world is full of these glamorous people walking around, you know, like look at me, I am perfect, you know, this is the ideal. I say, okay, wait a minute, look at this old person with a cane, and look at them, how they're walking, and how they're, you know, you say, wow, you know, they're gonna die soon, and look how everything is eroded. Everything that they had when they were young is eroded away. They've lost all this, you know. Now they're just, you know, they're crushed. They're slowly crushed. Existence has been slowly crushing them to death. Everyone's being crushed to death here in this world, in existence. You see that and say, wait a minute, you know, that is what's really going on, because these glamorous, beautiful body people, they're all going to be crushed as well. They're going to get all sorts of sicknesses and ailments, and someday they'll be rotting in a retirement home with bed sores, on massive amounts of medications, and then they'll be thrown into the crematorium. That's what's going to happen to them. So, you know, pay attention to the older people. See existence, what it's really about. It crushes everything. Destroys everything. That's not reality. In reality, nothing is ever destroyed. Everything that is created remains as it is eternally. And it exists. Reality expands. This ever expanding expression of creation. And yet, nothing that has been created is lost or harmed or diminished in any way. Everything remains as it is eternally. Where in existence, everything is crushed. And yet, in today's world, what are we looking at? We're told to obsessively focus on youth, because youth doesn't have the evidence of this crushing process, right? So we're all told to, we're supposed to look at, you know, youth, beautiful clothes, laughing, carefree, happy, perfect. Everything seems to be healthy and perfect and you know, carefree, and what a wonderful world, et cetera, et cetera. We're told to focus on that, which is how we sugarcoat existence. But I say focus on the dead, the dying, the sick, the infirm, the aging, the destitute, the depressed, all this stuff. This is what really happens. I mean, look at all the stars and starlets. What happens to their lives? They all fall apart. Tragedy, you know. Drug addictions, all horrible stuff. Lives that are just, you look at them and they're a mess later on in life. Look at that. Look what a mess these superstars turn out to be. Their lives. Horrible. Look at that instead. Say, well, wait a minute. Maybe all this stuff is just gloss. We're just glossing over existence. And that's what's being done. The gloss industry is enormous. Existence has to gloss itself over. Otherwise, you'll see it as it is. You say, oh, wait a minute, don't want that. That's not what I really want. No way. And we just continually don't look at that. We train ourselves not to look at that. only look at the good here, you know, try to find the positive things. And yet there's disasters, flooding, people dying, you know, drought. All this stuff is continuously taking place in the world. Everything is being transformed, continuously transformed. And yet here we are trying to look at the good stuff. You know, let me see, try to find some good stuff. Which is completely stupid. That is simply sugarcoating existence. That's all that it is. And it's keeping you extremely dumb. It's dumbing you down severely. Because if you see existence as it is, you'll say, I don't really want this. And then you will automatically search for what you really want and how to get it. And then you'll find out the answer that what you really want is to be reconciled with reality, to go back to full awareness of reality, stop the denial, and stop trying to change it. That's what you really want. And then you'll find out the way to do that, which is to choose a new idea and experience, abide in this unconditional love. You will search for the answer. If you see that you're in a situation you don't really want to be in, you'll search for the answer, how to get out of that situation. Guaranteed. How could you not do that? But if you think existence is what you want, you won't be searching for an alternative. You'll just be trying to repaint your house continuously, you know, reclothe yourself, keep getting finer and finer raiment for the body, put on wigs as you get older, put on more makeup, look more glamorous, better lighting, you know, everything like that. Just try to keep the illusion alive, as it were. Total waste of time. It's told that Gautama Buddha was born into this royal family, and they tried to allow the Buddha only to see the positive. No death, no sickness, no aging, nothing. They hid it on their estate. They had an army of caretakers hiding any evidence of decay. And one day the Buddha went outside the gates of the compound and saw some aging beggar there, and Buddha said, "Oh my God, what is this? Never seen anything like it before. Only saw beautiful, young, healthy bodies, right?" And Buddha said, "Whoa, I better find out what's going on here." And then from that point, focused on seeing existence as it is, and then said, "Wow, you know, I don't really want this. I'm going to find what I really want." And then did contemplation, great contemplation, and attained nirvana, which is the unconditional love, which is not an energy state. Just 1 minute. It must be emphasized that nirvana is not an energy state. It's not a state of stagnation. Nirvana means not moving. And we think, okay, the energy is just not moving. No, it's not energy. It's unconditional love. It's essence. It's not moving. It's not changing. It's effortlessly not moving, not changing. And it's not stagnant. It gives off this perfume of remembrance. It's perfect stillness, perfect gentleness, quietude, seamlessness. But that's not stagnation. So the idea that somehow we're supposed to stagnate energy, supposed to like arrest energy, keep it from moving, is not true at all. Not true at all. Give up your efforts to do that. That's impossible. Again, that's a transformational idea. Somehow we can transform energy into something it's not. Energy is a neutral thing, sure, but the purpose of existence is not a neutral thing. It's an agenda of process. So you cannot hold energy still for long. You can't even really hold it still at all. You can have an illusion of that, but there's always process pushing it. So it's not possible for energy to be simply in an arrested condition. It's only a temporary thing. It will only be at best. It can only be temporary, and when it's not stable. It is not stable because energy serves the purpose. It's simply a hallucination, as it were, a fantasy, and yet it serves the purpose of trying to develop a power of negation over reality. And that's what it moves, it transforms, it changes, it's constantly. Whereas nirvana comes from choosing a different idea, the idea of not trying to be prime creator, not trying to change reality, letting everything be as it is, not trying to change it at all. Gives rise to this unchanging effect that is not trying to be, not transforming, not changing. Without motion, nirvana is like they related it to energy, you know, because people are so used to energy. You relate, so well, it's like energy that's not moving. There's no moving, you know. But of course, energy cannot do that. So it's essence. It's not energy. Or you might say it's a reflection of essence. You could also say it that way. Possible. But those are details that are not important. Not really important at all. They don't really advance the narrative very effectively. So you can be the Buddha. Everyone can be the Buddha. In other words, everyone can see existence as it is. You can come out of our pagan sugarcoating. There's never, in the history of the world, there's never been a sugarcoating like there is now. It's the worst ever. There have been individual instances in history, like with the Buddhist thing, where there have been attempts to insulate people from the world and sugarcoat it in small samplings. But there's never been a situation where the entire world is engulfed in the sugarcoating like it is now. The imagery that is being used, the human imagery. And it's not only human imagery. It can be done without human imagery as well. But it's more, I think it's more, even much worse when you use human imagery. In advertising, in modeling, in photographs, depictions, plays, movies, television, everything. The human body using it that way is the pagan agenda. To sugarcoat existence. It's never been this bad. It has never been this bad. These times were foreseen. These times were foreseen. And existence can be foreseen. And we were told that it's going to get worse than we can imagine. And then we're in those times right now. We're in those times right now. Where everybody, there's a collective zeitgeist of focusing on the superficial, focusing on the sugarcoating. It's a collective thing. It's become a layer of consciousness, as it were. We feel that's what our purpose is. And so we feel that in order to have an identity, we need to embrace our purpose. You've heard teachers say we have to find our purpose in this world. Well, right now the purpose that existence is giving us is to embrace the superficial, embrace the sugarcoating. And we feel we won't have an identity unless we do that. We need to embrace this in order to manufacture an identity. And if we don't, we'll somehow feel like a lost identity. So it's a powerful, powerful thing that's going on. And you can call it a very wicked thing. A very, very, very unwelcome development in this world to an extraordinary extent. It's leading everyone astray. Everyone's being led astray, as always in this world. You know, an existence has to lead us astray to maintain itself, keep going. Otherwise, we'd say, I don't want this. I want something I really want. This will never be what I really want. So let me find what I really want. It'd be automatic. And then you'd focus in and you say, okay. And then automatically, what you really want, you become aware of it. You start becoming aware of it. You say, oh, this is what I really want, is to choose a new idea. Automatically, that happens. You know, and the inventions, all the modern inventions have exacerbated the problem to an unbelievable extent, like photography. You can make the world look so beautiful through photography, it's just unbelievable. And then digital retouching, digitally, you can make bodies look, you know, completely fake, artificial, but make them seem perfect. You know, every single blemish, the change, proportions, everything seems, you can make it ideal, you make everybody you see looks so ideal, so perfect, so flawless, so toned, so healthy, so happy. And you say, wow, that seems like something I might want, you know, I might want to be like that. And you don't realize everything you're seeing is in the media is fake people. Everything's made to look different. And that's just part of the times. That's part of the times. And it's not something that we should condemn. It's something we should just recognize. Recognize that and say, okay, that's what's going on, but let's not sugarcoat it. But we're so used to this now. Nobody will look upon the decrepit aging, you know. So even like in these videos, I put the lighting so it looks good, all right? Because nobody wants to look at something that looks terrible. I'm not going to do it. It used to be that people would wanted to look upon the sick and the infirm and see that and say, ah, that's my destiny. I don't want that. I don't really want that. But we're so addicted now to viewing human bodies and body beautiful, etc. And we won't even pay any attention to anything that's other than that, hardly, except to earn some compassion points, as it were. So when in Rome, do as Rome do, but the important thing is to convey the message of truth about the situation, even within the context of looking good in this world. It's an overwhelming situation here, truly overwhelming. We've made death invisible here. We've made sickness invisible. You know, everybody's propped up, and whatever's wrong, you get surgery, you fix it. You're sick, you take the pills. You get old, you keep putting dressing up, and we get too old, you're shunted off to some place, retirement facilities or some, you know, out of the mainstream. You don't want any old drivers on the road. Everybody's driving 80 miles an hour, driving like crazy. And the old people, you know, driving like this, and they're just trying to go maybe 45, 50 on the freeway. And people are just like, get off the road, you know. Get out of here. You're an embarrassment to my self-image of the body hero, you know, the heroic body. The culture is saturated with superheroes, right? The whole thing about superheroes is, again, sugarcoating existence entirely. That's what it is. All these comic superheroes, you know, are super popular, super popular in the world, because they seem invulnerable, right? They're all super muscular, super beautiful, super powerful, and who's super helpful, and all this stuff. And that is just a symptom of how sick the society is. Is by focusing on the body beautiful like that, the body powerful, the body as hero. That is egoic delusion at its very, very worst. Because we're, you know, people are now transferring organs. You know, you live a debauched life, you get a new liver. If you got the money, and you can drink like a fish, your liver goes out. You go and get a liver transplant and drink for another 15 years. Your heart goes out because you've been living too hard. You get a new heart. You get new limbs, you get new this, new that, you know. And you think, hey, no problem. And we keep thinking, you know, we can live forever, we can be young forever, and then we're doing genetic engineering and all this kind of stuff. And people are obsessed with their skin, aren't they? Obsessed with the skin. Oh my gosh, I got a blemish here. My skin's got to be perfect. And so we don't like looking at weatheredness. Who does? No, nobody does. But you need to see existence as it is, not as an end in itself, not like you're going to be looking at forever, but to recognize what it really is. It's this vicious, vicious, sacrificial system, belief system. It's a death factory. It's an attempt to find a way to destroy reality. And so we symbolize reality. We have all these symbols. And then we crush all these symbols, destroy them all. That's what it is. And once you see it, say, okay, then you don't have to dwell upon it. I don't go around looking, you know, for it so much. But you do have to notice. When you're able to notice something, just notice, say, oh, look at that, okay. Like I go out on a walk sometimes. I used to go out on a walk and as people are like saying, oh, look at that nice place, look at that beautiful tree, look at this. I go on a walk, I say, whoa, look at this. That's broken, that's sick, that's dying. That's not going to be here much longer. This, you could see the whole thing is decaying. Everything is dying. You can see it. And yet others will not even recognize that in the slightest bit. They'll just overlook it all, as if somehow they're spiritual by overlooking existence. That somehow that's very spiritual, like emphasize the positive. That's delusional. That's delusional. That is believing that existence can be transformed and expecting it to be transformed, as if we have some kind of transformational power. There's no such thing as a transformational power. There's an imagination of transformation. There's a belief in imagination, and we're simply like a dream. In a dream, you can transform anything, right? In a dream, you can have a mountain turn into the ocean if you want. You can transform anything in a dream. And so this dream of existence, of course everything can be transformed in this way and that way. But it can never be made real. Illusions can't be made real. Dreams cannot be made real. It's not possible. And so this is the type of focus that is all important in these severely pagan times. Sugarcoating times. Pour a little sugar on it, baby, as the pop song goes. And that's what we're all doing. Everybody's just, every morning they're pouring sugar. Pouring sugar, pouring sugar, pouring sugar. Again, that's par for the course. It's not condemnation. It's simply recognize it. You don't have to, like, try to be ugly or anything. Try to be old or infirm. That's not the point. Point is simply to recognize existence as it is, accept it as it is, and realize you can't change it. And then look for what you really want. What you really want. And you will then see what you really want is to choose a new idea. Because we have to function in the times that you live in. Okay, it used to be in the Middle Ages, you know, the ugliness was emphasized, and sickness and infirmity and crippledness and all that stuff. That was really, people focused on that, and they looked at that, and then they saw, oh my gosh, you know, existence is horrible. And so there were so many contemplatives then, so many saints, sages. Really, it was from a spiritual standpoint, it was a very, very profound time of so many awakening to the divine, to unconditional love. Whereas in modern times now, we're in, it's like nobody's awakening to it. Hardly anybody's awakening to unconditional love. And yet, and we're all focused on the body beautiful. You know, how can we make, you know, the body more beautiful? How can we paint, you know, get everything more, better groomed, you know, better smelling, better looking, better tone, more active, doing more stuff, all this kind of thing. That's where the focus is. So that's where we're at right now. And we're not, you know, you still within that situation can easily recognize existence as it is. When people get sick, they're hidden away, and they die, and then they're whisked away to the crematorium, boom, 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 you like that. A lot of times don't even have open caskets, because even in the casket, they're all dressed up beautifully. Like even in death, they you know, put all the wax and make everything look like they're fresh as a daisy as they're lying in the casket. You don't see the ravages of the situation. My best friend in high school had a horrible car crash. I was supposed to be in the car with him, but for some reason, my intuition, I just turned it down to the last second. And he didn't have an open casket, because he was in pieces. His body was in pieces, you know. And from that was very sobering, very sobering, very sobering for me. Shocking, you know. Wow, I was young, you know, when I was like 17. And he said, gosh, your very best friend is in pieces, you know. It's like, oh, hey, you know, existence is wow. You know, of course, I was aware of existence as it is always, but that brought it home, you know. And other people I knew growing up, somebody choked on their own vomit and died. Somebody was on a sled. One of my good friends was on a sled up in the Sierras, one of those discs, and he slid off, slid down the mountain and went underneath a gas truck and crushed him to death. You know, stuff like that. And you just like, whoa, wow. You know, it's not so great. It's not all lollipops and sunshine. It's like sunshine, lollipops, and da-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun. And here's this parade, constant parade of real perky, you know, perky people. All perky people. That's all a parade for fools. You know, the people are watching that parade are fools. You know, but now that's all it is, almost a parade. But so you have to see, observe, be very observant, be very observant. And of course, any time you go out in nature, you can observe it. You know, you can't hide. In nature, it's hard to hide it. Of course, you go on a golf course, it's pretty well hidden. No signs of sickness or death there. Which, of course, is refreshing, but it can also be delusional. When you take a walk out through the hills, you know, oh my gosh, you see the old, out around here, the old orchards, you know, all the apricot trees, you know, withered, dying. So many trees dying, broken, so many broken limbs everywhere from storms. So many trees desperately struggling to survive. Some, you know, are managing, others you can tell they're dying. Nature is just a hideous, hideous struggle for survival. And you know, everything you're seeing is going to be crushed very soon. So that, you know, it may seem depressing, but it's actually very enlightening, as it were. Say, hey, you know, I don't want this. I don't really want this. I don't really want to live here. I don't really want to be here. This is not my home. I don't want this to be my home. And then you think, well, I can transform. Can I really transform it? And then you work on transformation, and you put in, you do the work yourself, and you realize how brutally difficult it is, and how everything you do, you plant a perfect garden, and the next day the gophers come and start picking off stuff one after the other. It just happened with me. Had everything beautiful and perfect, and now it's just all a mess. You know, the deer come, eat all your fruit. They destroy your fruit trees. They destroy your vegetables. You battle against those. The fungus comes. The rot comes. The insects come. Everything is continually attacking. Energy is continually transforming. Can you stop the transformational process of existence? You cannot. You cannot, and you exhaust yourself battling against it, trying to transform the world. So the people that say we need to build heaven on earth here, they are blind leaders of the blind, and they're asking you to waste your time in futility. And there are people I know who attempt this, and they actually. They're rich, and they hire people, lots of people, to work on their house and yard, continuously trying to make it perfect. Like, it's not touched by decay. Nothing is touched by decay here. But it's an obsession. They're obsessed. It's an obsessional thing. You know, and it's a battle. You feel like, you know, you got to do it. You got to do it. You got to keep this illusion going that this is my home. This is where I want to be. This is what I really want. That's a delusion. That's just buying time for existence to develop this power over reality. We're just buying time by doing all this. All these perky people are saying, they're just buying time saying, hey, let's just buy a few more decades. Let's buy one more life of time. So maybe by the end of your life, we'll finally have developed this power over reality. And you get this propaganda constantly. Existence simply churns out propaganda. That's all that it does. Just keeps telling you, oh yeah, it's a fait accompli. We're just not sure when it's going to happen, but it's going to happen real soon. And the scientists will say, you know what? But before the end of your life, we're going to have immortality, and we're going to take a you're going to take a pill, and you'll feel like you're 21 years old again. And fun. Well, I'll have fun. And it's always guaranteed. Oh, it's definitely going to happen. You know, we'll have it. We'll have the answers. So I say, okay, I'll hang in there. I'll keep thinking positive thoughts. I'll keep seeing existence as a wonderful place. And I'll just hang in there until we get this power. And then we can use it then over reality and force the prime creator to change reality so we're prime creator. And then we'll really be happy. We know we're not happy now, but we're just pretending to be happy. because we think we need to buy time until we can get what we really want, which is what we think we really want is to be prime creator. And of course that's impossible, we'll never get it. So all this time that we're buying pretending to be happy is just wasted time. You know, don't pretend to be happy. Look at existence as it is and realize it's not a happy place at all. It's a terrible place. And then realize that's not what you really want. You don't really want that. And everybody, you know, throughout history has made great efforts to try and make it look, you know, like home, make this like home, beautiful homes, beautiful furnishings. Try to keep themselves beautiful. Once you got everything perfect, the yard, the home, everything, then you yourself, you work on yourself. And then, of course, you have a bad night's sleep, and you wake up, and you feel terrible. And you have to feel, your image is a peppy image, you know. You're very peppy, you're very beautiful, you're very assured, self-assured, very confident. You got to keep that image up. And you're just like, you know, you go home, you're dragging, and you have a crash from your coffee. You feel terrible, so tired, don't want anyone to see you so tired and wiped out. And so I gotta go out, you know, I've gotta look like I'm happy and go shopping. I need to keep feeding the shopping frenzy of the sugar coating. I need to keep coating, pouring more sugar on it. Buy, put on credit. Make myself look more happy. How can someone wearing a new suit of clothes, you know, not be happy? They're walking like, wow, I'm fresh, I'm new, I'm vital, I'm with it. Look at this, look at me, I'm happy. So everybody wants to keep putting on the Ritz, go to see others putting on the Ritz, and keep pretending to be happy. Eat a bunch of food that, you know, stuff yourself and say, wow, I just had a great meal. I just had a great day, had a great meal, I'm very happy. That's the religion of the times, where it used to be. Now I'm very unhappy. And this place is terrible. I hate existence. It's an awful place. I want to find my real home. And then they focus in, okay, how do I find my real home? And then you begin to clarify it. You say, wow, I really can return to my true home. The whole tale of the prodigal son is very apt. We've wandered away into a dream. We've gone into a dream, and we need to awaken from that dream and realize that we never left home in the first place. And reality is just waiting for us to awaken and celebrate the awakening, celebrate the remembrance. It's like a gradual awakening. We come out of this deep dream, gradually come out of it and say, oh my gosh, I never left reality. I never left what is. I never left isness. All this becoming, all this process, this dream was just a dream. No reality to it whatsoever. So we're not trying to make a dream better, we're trying to awaken from it. And you don't help your awakening by trying to make the dream better. That only deepens your delusion in the belief that you can change reality. The whole purpose of awakening to reality is to accept that you can't change it. So the more we try to change existence, the more deluded we become. The more we try to sugarcoat it, the more deluded we become, the deeper the dream becomes. Because we believe more strongly that we can change and effects, give the effects of an idea a different purpose. The more we believe that, the more we are alienated from reality. The more we're afraid of reality, because reality can't change. And we're searching for effects, the place where effects can leave their cause, and reality isn't that place at all. So it makes it worse. It makes it worse. What we have done, all under the guise and the banner of getting better, evolving our consciousness, hell, you know, we've gotten worse. I say the world has gotten much worse. Much worse. The sugarcoating that makes things much worse. The belief that we can change, transform existence, it makes things worse. And that's the culture, the world civilization that we live in right now is a profoundly diluted culture. Getting worse all the time, exponentially worse. That, yeah, we can build a utopia here. We can solve all the problems here. That makes things worse. When people get sick, like when I got sick, what'd I do? I said, wow, this is a teaching moment. I need to learn from this situation. What's going on? I need to recognize, wow, I lost my health even at an early age. Even youth can be devastated. My youth was absolutely devastated. Devastated as bad as you can have devastated other than dying, but it's even worse than dying, because dying, you know, it's real quick. My friend getting crushed or the car accident, boom, like that. They're gone. But in my situation, it's like a living death where I was young, but I felt like a 95-year-old, like I was going to die the next day. Every day I felt completely decrepit. And so I realized, you know, youth is no sanctuary. It's no sanctuary at all. So all this idea about youth as a sanctuary, you know, youth as our hope, holding up these images of youth, it is so delusional. You know, and some of the wisest people I've ever come across have had very ill childhoods and youth, and they never had their health. And then they said, whoa, you know, you cannot rely on the body at all. You can't rely on existence. No way. And then they seek for the answer, you know. They seek for the alternative to existence. Most people try to preserve their youth as long as possible. I didn't have any youth, didn't have any health, nothing to preserve. So I just said, okay, wow, I don't want this. This is not what I really want. So what do I really want? Is there an alternative? And then seek for the alternative. It's very helpful. And most of us are content to just try to prolong our youth, prolong our, you know, try to feel the energy, much energy as possible. Do stuff, go here, go there, distract ourselves with decorations and ornamentations and clothing and food and music and travel and whatever we can do to avoid contemplation, to avoid seeing existence as it is, and then contemplate, say, wait a minute, you know, what's the alternative? Let me find the alternative to this. I gotta find the alternative to this. Gotta find it, gotta find it, gotta find it. So when you lose your health, you're sick, use it as a motivational tool. Say, I feel terrible. Let me get to the root of this. What's going on? When I fall ill with various ailments and stuff, what I do is I simply then use that focus even stronger on contemplation. And invariably, that illness passes away, it goes away. Because I say, no, I don't really want existence. The more we focus on sugarcoating existence, the worse the sickness is going to hit us, the harder it's going to hit us. Because it's a camouflage for what's coming. You know the principle of denial. The worse the situation gets, the more you go into denial. The Titanic's about ready to hit an iceberg and sink, and the more people are dancing and the louder the band plays, you know, and the more they're gambling and the more they you know, the more beautiful the clothes are, and everyone's just partying even harder and harder and harder, and drinking more and more and more, and taking all sorts of drugs, and that's called denial. So when the world is just frantically sugarcoating itself through the body beautiful, you can bet that is a sugarcoating and a camouflage and a hiding for something that is really very, very drastic is about to happen. It's sneaking up on the world. And instead, and if the world turned to contemplation, it'd be a whole different ballgame. Whole different ballgame. We would use what's coming upon us. If we see what's coming, we'd use that pressure and deadline to choose a new idea, which is what I've done. I've seen what's coming in the world, and I accepted it. Instead of saying, no. Well, at first it was difficult. At first I did go into certain kind of denial in the body beautiful thing, in the fashionista thing. I thought, oh my gosh, maybe if I just dress up real dressed perfectly, disasters won't happen. But gradually I saw through it. That's not it. So it's not like you can be pristinely perfect about your responses. No, it's not like that at all. It's that you gradually have to shift the balance in you from denial to contemplation. So it's not that you can prevent existence from doing its dance, is that you can see the dance that's coming ahead of time, and then you can decide, I don't really want that. Okay, how do I sidestep that? What do I need to do? I can't stop it from happening, so what? You know, I can choose a different idea. I can dwell in the realm of unconditional love. I can dwell in the loss-free realm. There are alternatives to the dance of existence. And so you can use your time in contemplation. When you see problems coming, use it that way. And I found out, even if you see something coming, you tell people, they don't believe it. They don't believe it, because what their reaction is just to go more into denial. That's what I've seen. You can't change the purpose of existence. You cannot change it. So existence will continue its deadly march, its death march. That's all it is. Existence is just a death march. It will continue that. Existence will always be that death march. That's all it will ever be. So don't try and change it. Don't waste your time. Just contemplate the alternative and erode your reluctance to accept the alternative. That's what you need to do. As you are going along this death march, you don't be dreaming like, who's to blame for this? Let me get rid of the bad guys and put in the good guys and you know, let me do all that. No, forget it. Just say, wow, this death march is horrible. Let me see if I can get free of this entirely. What's the way to get free of this? What is the way? There must be a way. Contemplate that. And then you'll come across those who tell you, yeah, there is a way. There most absolutely is a way. Choose a new idea. Choose a new causative agent. As Jesus puts it, choose a new causative agent. I say choose a new idea, same thing. The teaching is the same. Its teachings are the same. Truth is the same. The remedy is simple. Anybody can say, yeah, this is the remedy. The remedy is to choose a new idea. That is the remedy. That's the only remedy there is. So of course we will all do that. Eventually we will all do that. And you don't have to do anything about existence except to choose a new idea, and then you're not experiencing existence anymore. It's a hypothetical. It was never an experience in the first place. It was an attempt to arrive. It was an attempt to manufacture, to arrive at an experience. Which the experience of having a power over reality. There is no such experience. You cannot experience having a power over reality. Cannot. So we haven't really been experiencing at all in existence, which is why when existence passes away, it will never return. Unless we choose to try and be prime creator again, then the same scenario will arise. I said in creation, everything is permanent, endless. Everything that is real is endless. But existence isn't real. It's an attempt to establish a new reality, which it's simply an attempt. It's not real, so it's not really an experience. We're not really experiencing anything here. Existence cannot be experienced. It's not possible. Whatever we think we're experiencing, it's just a belief that we're experiencing it. Everything changes. Everything, you know, there's no experiencing in reality is you know, can't even describe it, really. There's no time involved. It's endless. And it's not worth our time to even try and envision it, you know. But it's just important to point out that existence, when it passes away, when we set down that idea, it's like an idea that has no effect, no real effects at all. The idea of changing reality has no real effects at all. So it's like experiencing nothing. And that's not a real experience, is it? You can't say that you experience nothing. It's not possible. If it was nothing, there'd be no experience of it. So it's like it's just a nothing, that, and you just say, oh, that idea is not experienceable. So existence will pass away. Death will pass away. It's not like it remains as a permanent fixture in reality. No, because it was never real in the first place. And again, what is never real in the first place can never become real. cannot be transformed into the real, cannot. A fantasy, which, you know, just this imaginary fantasy of creating, of manufacturing some new reality, is just nothing but a whimsical imagination. It's not creation. It is not creation. Creation extends itself through the laws of the prime creator, which are eternal and unchangeable. And what we're trying to do is we're trying to pursue a hypothetical that's not under the laws of creation at all, that simply is under the plausibilities, under hypotheticalness, plausibility-ness, imaginary-ness, belief, simply whatever we want to be is, you know, whatever laws we want, rules we want, we just make them up as we go along, and that's, you know, that those are the rules and laws. That's not creation. We want to say that God created existence. We just make it up. We just believe it. We say, okay, it's real because we believe it, therefore it's real. We just made it up. That's not the laws of creation. Where whatever we believe is real. That's not the laws of creation. Where we can reverse cause and effect just because we believe it. No, that's not creation. Where we can make everything temporary. No, that's not the laws of creation. We're just making all of it up, imagining it, fantasizing it, hallucinating it. Jesus says existence is a hallucination. It's a hypothetical. I say it's a hypothetical scenario. It's hypothetical. What if? What if this were possible? We're just doing a what if. What if this were possible? What if this were real? What if we could transform? What if we could transmute? What if we could make the unreal real? What if we could turn nothing into more than everything? What if? It's a what if we could situation, which is hypothetical. What if we could do this? I'm just dreaming. That's like, you know, dreamers say, well, what if I could, you know, jump to the moon? Or what if I could do this? What if I'm dreaming? What if I could reverse the laws of creation? What if I could be the prime creator? What if I could do this? It's a hypothetical. This can never be real. Just a hypothetical. We're just dreaming. But the dream, we don't like the dream. And we think we can change it. We don't like all this death and dying and a horrible price we're paying for this horrible dream. Well, and we think, wow, we must be able to change it, make it better. No. Because in order to pursue this idea, we have to find a way to force the prime creator to change reality, because we can't change it. And the only way to try and force the prime creator is to try and develop a threat to the prime creator, a threat of loss, a threat of destruction. We can say we want to have a power over reality, say we're going to destroy reality if you don't change it for us. So we're trying to develop a threat of destruction, of negation, which is why everything dies here. Everything is destroyed. We can't escape it. That's what existence is. We can't escape that. We'll always be that way. And we can try to play the sympathy card too by saying, oh, prime creator, we're being destroyed. Your spirit is being destroyed. Existence is destroying your spirit. Save us. If you want to save us, you got to change reality. Play the pity card too. We do that too. That's also part of it. Prime creator says, you know, hey, you're not being destroyed at all, and reality can't be changed, so just give up this crazy idea, that this whimsical idea that you grabbed a hold of, and that's all the creator can do. Prime creator, not the prime creator of dreams, of hypotheticals. Reality does not create hypotheticals. Reality does not create hypotheticals. Never. Never, 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 never. So the prime creator is not that which gave rise to this hypothetical of existence, the scenario of loss and death and suffering, the scenario of negation did not give a rise to it. We as spirit gave rise to it by choosing to try and embrace the idea of being prime creator, being greater than the prime creator, supplanting the prime creator, being the one who sets the laws of creation. We're the ones who gave rise to it by our choice. And we can choose again. We have to choose again. That's the only way out. Choose again. Choose once again. That's the only way out. The only way out, Jesus said, there's only one way out, which is true. Choose once again. There are not multiple ways out. There are multiple ways to gain conviction that you need to choose once again. But ultimately, the only way out of the situation is to choose once again, choose a new idea. That's the only way. And so focusing on that is all important. Making your efforts towards what actually works is all important. Otherwise, you won't succeed. So you're either going to sugarcoat the world or you're going to focus on contemplation. In this present world, the situation we live in right now, a little sugarcoating is going to take place. You know, you're not going to walk around in a sackcloth. I mean, you're not going to, you know, in the past, mortification of the flesh, asceticism, all that kind of stuff was practiced extensively. People emphasize the fragility of the flesh, the mortification of the flesh, the destiny of the flesh, which is to rot and maggots take care of it. They emphasized it to make sure that they didn't slip into sugarcoating it. And people who go to that extreme, what happens in existence, you oscillate between extremes. All these people in the world now are sugarcoating it, so much sugarcoating, they will flip-flop in the future into asceticism and mortification of the flesh. There'll be these people with wearing sackcloth whipping themselves and tearing the flesh and making themselves look horrible and gruesome and all this kind of stuff. The importance of people in Christianity, they focus on the crucifix, a lot of them. And on the crucifix, there's Jesus. It's a body that's completely mortified and torn up and dying, etc. And that is for the purpose of reminding ourselves the vulnerability of the flesh. Okay. You don't see Jesus, with a radiant golden crown and dressed in purple robes and perfect teeth and smiling. No, you see, a dead Jesus with bloody and torn to pieces, horrible, pierced in the side, nails, nailed through the hands and feet. And not torn to pieces, but flayed, with what I mean is all the whipping, flaying the flesh and horrible stuff. That sobers you up and say, whoa, wait a minute, this is the body horrible, the body dead, the body destroyed. This is our destiny here. Existence crushes us. And I guess Christians thank Jesus for showing us, what this existence really is. Giving us this physical representation and showing us, hey, don't trip into the body beautiful thing. Don't do that. So those who are doing the body beautiful thing now will flip-flop into, focus on mortification of the flesh type of thing in the future. But when you make that an end in itself, again, it's futile if you make an end in itself. Without contemplation, mortification without contemplation is a waste of time. Asceticism without contemplation is a waste of time. You don't have to do all that. If you do contemplation, you don't have to do all this mortification type of thing, crucifixion. You don't have to focus on all that. So contemplation is the true path. It's focusing on how do you get what you really want. And making you realize, focusing on the power of choice. Power of choice. You can hook yourself up with hooks onto a crucifix and be whipped and starve and no water and be mortified and go through all that all you want to, as some do in some cultures, and not be any the wiser from it, really. A lot of that is just to release all these endorphins to, give them this sort of thrill, inner kind of endorphin sort of thing. It's a waste of time. It's a waste of time. Don't mortify the flesh. Nobody's suggesting you mortify the flesh. Contemplate. If you just swing back from the body beautiful to mortification of flesh, you just go back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. Neither one really works. Both of them are distractions from contemplation. But if you use an image like a crucifix as a reminder every day, you look at the crucifix and say, oh boy, I better get contemplating today, you know, because I know this body's going to end up on that cross, as it were. All bodies end up on the cross. All dead. All bodies. So you say, I better spend the day contemplating. Then that's a right use of it. You can make right use of it. And Jesus came to remind us of our death, remind us that existence is this death march. And then the resurrection reminds us that we can choose a different idea. And in that different idea, there is no death at all. Completely free of any mortification. Unconditional love. No change in it whatsoever. Cannot be changed, cannot be harmed in any way, shape, or form. So those two teachings, crucifixion and resurrection, very, very helpful, very important actually. Not essential. You can just take a walk in nature and see everything. Mortification of nature, you can see it. It's easy to see it. Then contemplation, you can the clarity within you will tell you, yes, choose a new idea. You can do it that way too. People in the past were very visual, very, very dramatic, and that symbol of the crucifixion was very powerful to them. And today, it's not. For some people, it's not as powerful. For me, it doesn't really do anything for me. For me, what is powerful is contemplation and clarification of and using reason, that kind of thing. That's what's powerful. But you know, different times, different things spoke to people in different ways. They gripped their attention. So different teaching methods are used in different times depending on what can really convey and grip the attention and focus of people at that time. Doesn't remain constant because everything in existence is constantly being transformed. So the methodology of your attention is also changing along with the times. Bottom line, though, you do have to do the contemplation. That is the bottom line. You do have to quietly assess and just see what will arise in your mind. Quiet it all down. Don't be trying to sugarcoat anything. Just see what arises. Look at what arises. Pay attention to it. Pay attention to dreams. Pay attention to what arises. Pay attention to how the mind is working, how it's trying to distract. Hold on to an insight, and you get an insight, and then suddenly you find it whisked away. You say, why did it get whisked away? What is it that caused me to lose my train of thought? That's contemplation. You contemplate, you'll find there's interference with it. And then you track down what is interfering with it. Why is it being interfered with? I want to hold on to this clarity, and yet I lost it. Why? So you start asking, why? Why did I lose it? Why did I lose this? I had the answer, and now it's gone. Why? I'm afraid to go back. Why am I afraid? What's giving rise to this fear? That's inquiry. That's inquiring. Inquire about your own reactions, about your own loss of clarity. Everyone can do it. Because we all can get clear about something, and then we forget it, don't we? It's gone. Why did it go? Where did it go? Why did it go? What's going on here? How come I can't keep steady? How come I can't keep my mind steady on it? And you look, keep looking, inquiring. Now, I don't believe that the goal is to train your mind to be steady. I believe the goal is to choose a new causative agent, okay? It's ridiculous to keep your mind steady on existence. Existence itself is unsteady. So it's like you have a steady focus on what is unsteady. What is that? Choose a new idea and it's effortless. People asked Sri Anandamayi Ma, who is in this effortless bliss, effortless unconditional love, and they're saying, "Is it? How do you keep this state? Is it difficult for you?" And she said, "What? No. It's not a state of mind." She'd say, "It's not. I'm not in a state of mind. I don't have any state of mind at all." And it's completely effortless. It's utterly effortless. I'm not making any effort at all to maintain some state of mind. It's because it's the effect of a different idea. which is steady state, unchanging state, inherently so. There's no effort needed whatsoever to maintain it. An idea doesn't have to make an effort to maintain its effects. Effects automatically are aligned with the purpose of an idea. There's no need for any effort whatsoever. What we're doing in existence, we think we're making efforts to maintain the effects. We're not. We're making efforts to maintain our loyalty to this idea so we don't choose another one. That's the effort we're making. But when you choose the idea of not trying to change reality, that's what you really want, and so you're not making any efforts to try and change that idea. You don't want to change it, so you don't need any effort at all. The effects are effortless, and abiding in that idea is effortless because you're not trying to change out of it. So that's a far, far different thing than trying to maintain a steady mind in this world. I got to keep my mind steady, got to keep my mind focused, you know. Far different thing. You're not trying to become a yogic master. You're trying to abide in unconditional love. Very different. You're not trying to have an immortal body here. You're trying to abide in unconditional love, which is immortal and eternal and endless. That experience, it's always there for you. Whether the body lives or dies makes no difference, because the awareness is spirit, and spirit is not subject to decay or death whatsoever. And if you're experiencing what can never die or decay or anything, then you are experiencing your own eternal nature. And so then at that point, what death of the body, what do you have to fear? You're not losing any experience from the death of the body, which is a different thing. Those who are in that unconditional love have no fear of death whatsoever. They don't try to hasten it, but they have, why? Either way, it makes no difference. Whether the body's living or dying makes no difference to their experiencing, because the experiencing is not of the brain, of the body. It is of the spirit, of the awareness of spirit, experiencing that which can never die. See? So the fear of dying, gone. And we absolutely can do that. Every single one of us can't. Not only can we do it, we will do it. Only when we will do it is something that we can, you know, talk about. Is a variable, so to speak. And even that may be set. Jesus said it's set. When each one of us will choose a new idea is actually already set. It's something that's going to, and it's probably true. And yet we, as we get closer to it, we automatically do the contemplative work in alignment with it, etc., etc. So is there free will in existence or not? You know, well, whatever the case may be, we do certainly have to do everything we can to prepare for and align with and remove the fear and realize that choosing a new idea is not traumatic. All of this gets us ready for it. It's like ready for a new birth or something. But it's not traumatic like a birth. It's like a non-birth. It's a simultaneously arising, where everything is born together. The whole all of the universe is reborn simultaneously. So it's not like this part of the universe has been reborn, this part it's not. That would cause all sorts of confusion. One second. Okay. Well, the day calls, duty calls, etc., etc. But it's very important each day to align more and more with the fact that you will choose a new idea. It's not traumatic, and it will truly be what you really want. And just keep aligning with that, keep aligning with it, Of course, you're going. The world is with everybody here. But try and, you know, avoid the sugarcoating as much as possible. Not obsessively, but just be aware of it and say, no, wait a minute. If you're doing contemplation automatically, you're not engaged in sugarcoating it, you know, pretty much so. And the situation is not as scary as you might think. Choosing a new idea is not as nearly as scary as you might think. It's the unknown seems scary, right? And say, I've never done that. I haven't done it. It's unknown. I don't know if I can do it, you know. And it's actually natural for us because in reality we choose new ideas all the time. So you can approach it, and as you get closer and closer, it's less and less scary. And you get a little closer, looking at it up close, you say, oh, it's no big deal. I mean, it's not scary. I should be able to do that. When we start out, it's very mystical, and these people who've done it, those who've done it, seem like these incredible figures, you know, unbelievable, these icons of history, etc., etc. As you get closer and closer and closer, the awe disappears, and you see, oh, it's just a matter of, okay, not a problem. And so you gradually change, and you know, your emphasis gradually changes, and the awe drops away, the fear drops away, the lack of conviction drops away. The anxiety lessens. Checking my anxiety levels right now. Very low anxiety levels. Still a tiny bit. They're still tiny. You never get rid of it entirely until you do it. That's what I've been told. But it's very low. Like, or it's at like 1%. Used to be at like 99%. Now it's like at 1%. That's pretty good. That's a pretty successful endeavor. I'm trying to amplify it now, let's see, but just amplifies a little bit and then drops back down. So, whereas before, I tried to amplify it and kaboom, you just get out of control. Anxiety running riot, you know, couldn't stop it. The idea of choosing a new idea, that notion of choosing a new idea, I knew I had to do it, but it was frightful, very frightful idea. My gosh, it was terrifying. And now it's not terrifying at all. That's the path. I mean, the option is set. Everyone has to choose a new idea. It's the only way out. The path is to overcome your fear of doing this. And so I've gone to 99% fear to 1%. And so it's doable. It absolutely is doable. It's just a matter of working at it. Every day you chip away at it. If you work hard today, you'll go from 99% to 98.7% or something like that, right? 98.9%. Work at it tomorrow, a little less, a little less, a little less. You work at it, you know, for 1 year, you might go from 99% to 90% fear. And you keep working at it. It's still a lot of fear. Work at it for a decade, you go from 99% to maybe, you know, 60%. Work at it for 30 years, you go from 99% to 10%. You keep working, you get it down to 1%. Or, you know, I'm just making, you know, just giving, throwing out ballpark stuff. You might do it a lot quicker than that. Or it might take a little longer, I don't know. You can get it down to 1%, you know, very low, which is, again, not an end in itself, but it's, I'm just telling you, it definitely can be done. I've done it. Just reporting, sharing this personal experimentation with the world, going from 99% full-blown, out of control, free-floating dread and anxiety and panic to 1%, where the contemplating doing it right now, it just causes the slightest, a little tremor, you know, a little ripple is all that it's causing, little ripple. And amplify, I'm seeing if it can amplify, how bad it will amplify. you can amplify it a little bit. That's all. Nothing that's even worth paying attention to, really. So, absolutely is doable. So just do it. Just do it. Just work on it. Whittle it away. You have to whittle it away. You have to whittle it away. You have to work at it every day. And, you know, one day you put 1 day of effort into it, and you will have lowered your anxiety levels. And I tell you, you got no choice. Because you have to choose a new idea, and you have to overcome your fear of doing that. So all you do is just work at that. Just work at it. Nothing else to do in existence. That's it. Everything else is just fluff. It's not important. You have to lower your fear level. Progressively lower it, lower it, lower it, lower it. That's the purpose of existence. That is the purpose you can give existence. Now, you cannot change the purpose. You cannot change the purpose of existence. What you're doing is you're just aligning with a new idea, the purpose of choosing a new idea. That's what you're aligning with. You're not changing the purpose of existence, but you are choosing, aligning with your desire to choose a new idea. So that's your purpose. You want to choose a new idea. Which itself is an idea. The idea of choosing a new idea is itself a kind of idea. So you're aligning with that purpose. You want to choose a new idea, and you're aligning with that purpose. All right. And now I'm going to get on with the day. So very great. That's it for this video.